Hello, and welcome back to CS631 Advanced Programming in the UNIX Environment. After we visualized how the file system handles directories and links in our last video segment, we'll now take a look at the system calls used to create, remove, and rename both hard and symbolic links. Okay, so to create a new hard link, we can call the linksys call. Note that this takes as arguments two path names, not file descriptors, and is in this way a bit different from the other I/O syscalls we discussed in week 2. This makes sense though, since we established that hardlinks are a mapping between a filename and an inode. More explicitly, a hardlink is a directory entry, and so is independent of a file descriptor which references a given file, and which is independent of the filename by which it may have been opened. Secondly, note that in order to create a hardlink, the source file must exist. After link completes, it increments the link count of the file in question. Consistent with the various other syscalls we've already seen, we also have the linked variant to handle relative path names outside of the current working directory atomically. Note that on the UNIX file system, creating a new link maps a filename to an inode number. As we've seen in our last video segment, inode numbers are file system specific, and so we cannot have a hardlink that points to another file system, as that would require a mapping of filename to device plus inode number. Now, POSIX does allow for this, but most UNIX systems have not implemented hardlinks across file systems. This serves as a reminder that not all the things a standard allows, but not prescribes, are necessarily implemented everywhere. It also may simply not make a whole lot of sense. Secondly, note that creating a hardlink to a directory is not permitted unless the effective UID is 0. The reason for this is that multiple hardlinks are indistinguishable when traversing the file system, and a hardlink to a directory might cause a file system hierarchy loop, which could lead to file system corruption. These last two bullet points here are part of the reason why symbolic links were invented to overcome these limitations, and the behavior of symbolic links is rather different from hardlinks. We'll observe this in a few minutes. Okay, now we know how to create hardlinks. How do we delete them? Removing a hardlink is done via the unlink system call. Just like link increments the link count, so does unlink decrement the link count. As demonstrated in our last video segment, this link count helps the system determine when the file data blocks can be released or marked as available by the file system. Since we can have multiple names in various places on the file system pointing to the same inode, we cannot allow the system to override the data blocks until we are certain they are no longer needed. This is done by checking whether the link count is 0, that is, no more directory entries exist that point to this inode. But that alone is not sufficient. A process P could have opened the file, after which the directory entry was removed by this or another process. Now the link count of the file would be 0, but if you allow the data blocks to be overwritten, then the I/O operations on the file descriptor that process P has opened could be inconsistent. Therefore, the system will only release the data blocks when both the link count is 0 and no process has opened file handle to this file. Here, let's demonstrate what this looks like in practice. Here, we have a program that will show the available disk space as we add and remove hardlinks. And we begin by showing the currently available space. Then, we're creating a 500 meg file and showing the change in disk space. And then, we're creating a second hardlink to this newly created file. We inspect the output of ls-li and again report on the available disk space. Then we open the file and immediately unlink it. At this point, we have a file handle open for the file that was unlinked. We again show the disk space afterwards. And then we will unlink the second name for this file. We again run ls and df, and finally close the opened file descriptor, which we have kept still. Okay, let's run it. Okay, so we now see the available disk space here. Next, we're creating the 500 meg file and see the change in disk space. We use up 3% more of the total space. Then we create the second hard link, and LSLI shows us that the two files are identical, same inode number, and a link count of 2. The available disk space has not changed, even though it looks as if we had a second 500 meg file here. Next, we opened foo on file descriptor 3, and unlinked foo. LSLI shows foo gone and bar still present, with the same inode number, but now a link count of 1, and the same amount of disk space remaining available as before we unlinked foo. Okay, now we've unlinked bar. Neither foo nor bar exist, as ls confirms, but the amount of disk space available hasn't changed. The data blocks have not been freed yet, because we still have FD3 open. Finally, after we close FD3, we see the data blocks being released. Here's what this looked like in our illustration from before. Note that at no time, even after we are done, did we actually remove the data on the data blocks. That is, the term remove that we usually use really only applies to the directory entry. We never really remove a file. We remove a link to a file. This is why even if you accidentally remove the directory entry, the data is not lost and can oftentimes still be found and recovered from the disk. But okay, let's see. Here we have two file names. We remove one, and obviously the data on disk remains available via the second file name. If we remove that second link, then the link count is now 0. And if no other process has the file open, the file system can release the data blocks by removing the mapping of inode to data blocks. And the inode becomes available to be reused. Okay, now with this illustration in mind, we also remember how we talked about renaming a file within the same file system in our last video segment. For that, we used the rename system call, which behaves reasonably like one would expect. If from is a file and to does not exist, then it's easy. We simply create a new link named to and then unlink from, although these operations are performed atomically. If to exists and is a file, to is unlinked, from is linked to to, and from is unlinked. If we're trying to rename a file to a directory, we get an error. That is, the behavior of the mv command, whereby moving a file into a directory creates a file under that directory, is a nicety of the program to meet user expectations, not part of the rename syscall. For hopefully obvious reasons, we need to have write permissions in the directories we're making changes in. Unlinking a file and creating a new link both modifies the directory. If we're renaming a directory, things behave in much the same way. We can rename a directory to another directory if that directory is empty. If it contains entries, we get an error. Renaming a directory to a file makes no sense, so it yields an error. Just like before, we need write permissions on the affected directories. But with a directory, we have one more edge condition. You can't rename a directory to become a prefix of itself. Let's take a look at the different error scenarios. Here's the world's simplest mv command, quite literally consisting of a call to the rename syscall. Let's see. Renaming a non-existent file doesn't work. No surprise. Renaming an existing file works as expected. Now, renaming a file to itself works. This may seem confusing, but makes sense in the sequence of calls executed. Renaming a file to a directory will fail as promised. Renaming a file into a directory by specifying the correct destination filename will work. Now, renaming a directory, even one that has files in it, will work. But renaming a directory to a non-empty directory does not work. But we can rename a directory to replace an empty directory. We cannot rename a directory to a file. And now let's play around with deeper nested directories. We cannot rename a directory to its parent directory, because that directory contains an entry for the directory you're trying to move, so it's not empty. And we can't rename a directory into itself, which makes no sense. We also can't use rename to cross file systems. Remember, /temp is a separate system, a memory file system in our reference VM. And finally, of course, we do need write permissions on the directories we're operating on. Okay, so we've seen some of the limitations of hardlinks. We can't link across file systems, an implementation limitation, and we can't create links to directories. But sometimes it's useful to just do those things, which is why we have the symlink syscall. Symlink creates a symbolic link, a file that contains as its only contents the path name of another file, and which, when operated on, says, "Hey, don't look at me, look at that guy." The neat thing about symlinks is that you can create symbolic links to any type of file, including those that do not exist or that are directories, for example. When you want to get information about the symlink itself, instead of the path name it references, you'd use the L family of functions, lstat, lchown, lchmod, etc., as we've discussed in previous lectures. Here, let's implement the world's most trivial ln-s command. Okay, so we can create a symbolic link to a file that doesn't exist. This succeeds. Operations on file 2 will then tell us that the file in question doesn't exist, as it redirects to file. But as soon as we create the destination of the symlink, catting file 2 will work. Symbolic links can point to anything, including another symbolic link. And the indirection will follow through on this. But this, of course, means that it's possible to create cyclical chains of symlinks, where file 3 now points to file 2 points at file, and file points back at file 3. Fortunately, the file system detects this and errors out rather than going into infinite dereferencing loops. Nice. You can have symbolic links to subdirectories, which then also might lead to weird file system traversal. Like so. But again, the file system at the shell may be smart enough to detect this. But directory expansion or tab completion may start to look weird. Like here, via the dot dot symlink into the parent, we really only created a symlink into the current directory. But it contains this very long path name, pointing ultimately to Oh, well, not this file. Rather, the file in dir. I told you this can get confusing. Let's try to fix it. Here, create the file under dir, and our symlink with a weird long name will work again. Unlike hardlinks, you can create symbolic links across file systems, since a symlink really only contains a path name, nothing else. Now, here we've seen how operations on the symlink always dereference the target, but we've also seen how ls-l can tell us what the link points to. How does it do that? Calling open on the symlink won't work, since that dereferences the target, and there's no lopen call. So instead, we have a special syscall to get you the contents of a file of type symlink, the readlink syscall. You hand it a buffer of an appropriate size and tell it to fill in the buffer. But note that this buffer is not null terminated, meaning you have to ensure proper handling yourself. So if you were to implement, say, the ls command and want your -l flag to print the destination of a file of type symlink, then this would be the way to do it. All right, time for another break here. Enough with all the symlinks and hardlinks already. But looking back at the last few segments, you should now be able to implement several more of the common UNIX commands, ln, mv, and rm in particular. We'll keep in mind how the link count allows us to decide when we can free up data blocks. And we understand how moving files within the file system is trivial and fast, independent of the data blocks, but crossing file system boundaries will require copying of data. We've seen how symbolic links can reference any files, and we've played around trying to create loops in the file system. Try for yourself, try to be more creative and find clever ways to abuse symlinks to trigger unexpected behavior or output. In our next video segment, we'll do a deeper dive into the structure of a directory and how we might go about creating and removing those. Thanks for watching. Until next time. Cheers.